So, good afternoon, everyone. I understand this was normally going to be part of a double bill on ethics and privacy. So I know nothing about ethics and I work in computer security, so I will not actually give you a lecture on ethics at all. I will go straight into talking about privacy, which happens to be my research area. First of all, can everyone hear me, even though you're at the very back there? All good. Okay, good. So I'm an Alan Turing fellow, and it's my first full day here, if you want, so it's great to actually meet you all, and in theory I should be here every Monday. If you're looking for me, just send me an email to confirm. In my previous life, I was at, I still am actually, at UCL, so I'm a professor there of security and privacy engineering since 2013. Before that, I was actually at Microsoft Research, where my boss was again Blake, basically, Professor Blake. And there I was both doing research full-time on privacy technologies, and I also fulfilled the role of privacy champion in the lab. So this is a fantastic role, because every research project that had any kind of user-facing data collection component was going through me in a legal department to make sure that any privacy concerns were alleviated technically and also legally and in any other possible way. So I got to get some real hands-on experience on operational matters when it comes to actually taking care of privacy in the context of a scientific lab, and I'd be very happy to advise you if you have any question in relation to that. Way before that, pretty much last century, I did my studies in Cambridge and also did a postdoc in Leuven, but that's a whole other story. So on my day-to-day research life, I work on these systems known as anonymous communication. So some of you may have heard of Tor, the onion router. It seems to be the main system that everyone hears about when it comes to anonymous communications, but in fact there is a huge research field these days that look at how can you create communications without leaking metadata, identities, and all that stuff. So that's what I do day-to-day. Now, when I say it like that, people get the impression that I spend most of my time kind of building such systems, but in fact I spend most of my time attacking such systems using advanced statistics and machine learning. So I kind of work both in attack and defense quite a bit. Other things I do is I look at location privacy, I look at the economics of privacy as well, what makes deployments more or less successful. I, of course, and you will see why, work on applied cryptography more broadly than for privacy. And finally, I have a very special interest in infrastructure and privacy. And again, I think that this talk will make it obvious why infrastructure is a particularly interesting topic to look at when it comes to privacy. So my email address is there, and the coolest URL for a website on Earth is also there, since it's just my surname with a dot, in case you forget it. So you can just look at all my work and chat with me. Now, I was asked by the Turing to provide resources so that when you come out of this lecture, besides being able to go back to YouTube and see it, you know, you can also have a reference to everything we talked about. And the Turing was not the first one to ask me for that. In fact, the European Network Agency, Network Security Agency, ENISA, had exactly the same need, because this is a need that exists across the whole of the European and beyond industry, namely advice on, I have some technical product or some technical idea, how do I go, what kind of options do I have about protecting my users' privacy. So a bit more than a year ago now, we wrote a report along with other experts in Europe about what is basically the state of the art and the gold standard, if you want, that you should be applying when building technical solutions to build in privacy by design, and we will see what that means exactly. So I do recommend this report, because it provides a fantastic overview about all the tools and all the kind of techniques and all the research, if you want, around this topic, if you want to have a reference to that. Interrupt me at any time. I usually lecture theaters of hundreds of people where there is at least one interruption a minute, so I'm not going to be fazed by that. Just stop me as soon as anything is not obvious or you want to comment on something. Now, my background is security engineering, and I'm quite proud of that, and I studied privacy as part of that kind of tradition and background. Now, there is much more to privacy, right? Privacy as a human need has psychological components in its terms of its influence on the politics and the sociology of our society. It has a whole other discipline that could deal with that. Privacy, as we will see, has a legal basis in many jurisdictions, so lawyers would basically give you a different story. However, I come from a narrow kind of technical perspective. And why is it that within computing, concerns around privacy were first identified within the context of computer security? I mean, this is not the most obvious maybe context. And the reason for that is that traditionally, when people started thinking about privacy, they started thinking about the need that people have to keep secrets. So very often, the first stop when you deal about privacy is confidentiality, right? Users have a feeling that they need to keep some secrets. How can they use technical systems while trying to keep their secrets, right? And confidentiality is a very traditional property that security engineering tries to provide in systems. And this was the starting point. But down the line, it became apparent that confidentiality, even when we just deal with technical systems, is not actually the right framework to really conceptualize privacy. And people started thinking more of privacy in terms of control. It is not the case that you try to keep secrets all the time. It is the case that you try to share information with some people, not others, or have information about you being used in some operations and not others, and to provide some kind of services and not others. And you want, as a user, if you want, to stay in control of that and make sure that the information you provide is not used for other purposes, does not exceed the recipients that you intended, etc. So that was a more broader interpretation of privacy, which again kind of fits within the context of computer security broadly, not just confidentiality. Finally, in the last 10 years, there was a further broadening, if you want, of what privacy means in technical systems to really encompass aspects of kind of self-actualization. The individual within the context of technical systems wants to kind of be an agent, impose their will on this technical world, right? And privacy technologies and privacy, you know, can be conceptualized in that context as well. For example, it may include things like the ability of the individual to communicate despite attempts to censor an individual. Technologies, for example, to bypass national firewalls are usually studied within the context of privacy and privacy technologies, which is not obvious, right? Because it's not about keeping secrets, trying to traverse firewalls. It is trying to communicate despite the attempts to block you, if you want. So, it is not an either or. There are all these concepts of privacy, and different people, when they say privacy in the context of a conversation, will mean a mixture of all this or even more, sometimes taken from sociology and law and psychology. And we're totally comfortable with the fact that we never really start a talk about privacy technologies by providing the definition of privacy. There is no such thing. Actually, looking for the definition of privacy is like looking for the definition of love or the definition of freedom or, you know, all of these things. It's a wild goose chase. It will not actually lead us anywhere. Privacy is a multifaceted property, and we have to live with it. Nothing suggests that more than a seminal study by Daniel Solove, who's actually a legal scholar, who went back many years of US case law that dealt with notions and cases relating to privacy and effectively made a taxonomy of potential privacy harms that have occurred in the context of those cases. And he published this fantastic report, A Taxonomy of Privacy, that makes a list effectively of those harms and really illustrates the multifaceted aspect that privacy takes in technical system and also filing system, organizational systems, etc. And this picture is very important to keep in mind when you deal with technology and privacy, because as we will see, it's also the picture that data protection as a legal framework for dealing with privacy in the European Union has in mind. So in that picture, there is usually a data subject that has some information about them that they wish to maybe share with others or protect or whatever. And usually there is some kind of data holder. Maybe that's a service, maybe that's an email provider, and maybe that is someone else, basically. And of course, as part of normal operations, usually the data subject has to share some data with the service in some way or another for their benefit, usually. Or is kind of compelled to do so, for example, with the state or in order to use an infrastructure, right? I mean, sometimes the state compels you, for example, to declare your taxes. It's not really an option whether you're going to provide information or not. And Daniel Solove says that as part of this quite typical interaction, many harms can occur. And these harms are backed by particular case law that is very interesting to follow if you're interested from the report. Just to pick on a few, because otherwise it would be fully a talk about that, he mentions when basically the holder, the data holder, seeks information, there could be a harm that is surveillance. So when, for example, the data holder observes the subject without the subject being entirely aware of what's going on, okay? Or interrogation in itself may actually be intrusive. So when the holder asks questions that the individual may feel compelled or feels that if they do not answer, harm may occur to them, that in itself is a harm, that is already an attempt at their human dignity, if you want. Of course, once the data is in the custody of the data holder, many privacy harms also could potentially materialize. The data holder could aggregate that data with other data and learn more than what the data subject anticipated, if you want. They could use the data to identify the subject or others in ways, again, that were not anticipated or wanted. Of course, they could use the data for other uses. They could use the data for excluding the data subject from their rights or services or whatever else. And of course, a lot of harms materialize not just when the data remains with a holder, but when for one reason or another the data goes further than the holder, right? So for example, if the data holder does not abide by their promises and starts divulging that information without the data subject wanting that, that is a harm. Of course, blackmail, appropriation, distortion of that information could also lead to other harms. One thing that is very interesting is the idea of decisional interference and intrusion, because it doesn't really involve a relationship with a data holder. I wish I had a lot of time to tell you more about that, but I will just point that out for you to have an incentive to go and read the original paper that is referenced here and leave it at that. Now, if we take a step back, Solove looks at this issue of privacy, and a lot of the examples he has are about technology, not always about information technology, but about technology throughout the 20th century in America. But the right to privacy is broadly something we care about because it is a fundamental right and it has been recognized as such internationally. So, for example, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, Article 12, entrenches the right to privacy by calling it by really framing it in terms of the family, the personal life, etc., and states that any interference with that has to be within the rule of law. Okay, and that's really the gist of how legal scholars really perceive the protection of privacy. It's not an absolute right. It is not the case that the state usually absolutely cannot interfere with that right, but it has to be done within the rule of law. And in fact, UK law transposes that right into the Human Rights Act, again, by setting protections about privacy, family life, and the individual, and stating that any interference, again, has to be within the rule of law. And that is a pattern internationally, if you want. The right of privacy also is recognized and to some extent, as we will see, protected within the context of the EU treaties. Article 16 of the treaty, of the Lisbon Treaty, entrenches it and particularly states that the Commission and the European Union institutions should respect that right when processing citizens' data. But what is more interesting to us is that from there, and also preceding the Treaty of Lisbon, the EU has created one of the earliest frameworks for the processing of data according to some principles that are there in order to alleviate concerns about privacy. And these principles are what is known as the data protection principles. And broadly speaking, what these principles ensure is that any data that refers to an individual has to be processed according to some rules. Okay? And it is not just, you know, the same as, you know, collecting some sensor data about daylight or, you know, any other kind of bulk collection of data. If data refers to individuals, it has to be processed according to those principles. Now, we will look at those principles a little bit, and in particular, what it is worth keeping in mind is that there is a major revision of those principles that went on in the last few years, and what is known as the General Data Protection Regulation, the GDPR, is actually coming into effect in a year and a half, which actually restates those rules and strengthens them in many ways, and in particular states that any technical system that is designed has to apply a privacy by design methodology to make sure that the impact on users' privacy is minimized. And I will go into what privacy by design means in that context. However, before going into what is privacy by design, I would like to give you the anti-pattern of how to design privacy, namely how not to design privacy. And this anti-pattern is sadly what we observe very often when we actually look at how very popular even services were initially launched, or are still launched today in Tech City and Silicon Valley, etc. And the anti-pattern starts with basically someone having a bright idea, saying, well, you know, I have this vague idea about a service or a product, and what we will do is just collect a lot of data, right, for implementing that idea. The example you gave me earlier is awesome. We'll just stick a microphone on a box and we'll start recording things. And, well, maybe if you say, hey, Alexa, it will start answering some questions, right? It's not clear what it's useful for, but anyway, let's start with that, right? Okay. And then basically, because the idea is vague, because the business model is not set, because, you know, it's the start of something beautiful, but no one quite knows what it is or how it's going to work, the first thing that usually happens in that context is that a lot of data is collected. Right? And it's a pattern that we see again and again. When services are launched, the less certain there is about what they're going to do, the more data they collect, hoping that this will bring some value, bring some clarity. The creators of those services hope that no one notices for a while, but of course, eventually that data finds its way into the wrong place or is processed in ways that someone gets upset about. Privacy advocates jump up and down, class action lawsuits are launched, etc. And usually when the scandal breaks out, the first reaction is to reach for the lawyers, the second is to reach for the PR machine to say that, well, this is not a problem, really, right? Now, usually if the scandals persist, and usually authorities, either the FTC in America or the data protection authorities here in the EU generally, get involved, the first line of argumentation about why that data is necessary is that there is absolutely no way of running whatever service without having access to that data and usually all the data about users. Okay? And, you know, the hope is that data will keep getting collected, you know, until the company usually is sold as a unicorn and it goes away. So let me say this is not the right way of going about things. So if you have a research project or a business idea, this is not the right thing to do. If you're Facebook, it will work out, but probably it might actually kill your company on the first scandal. Okay, so don't be overly influenced by the handful of success stories that just followed that pattern. Try to actually do something more clever and more sophisticated about privacy. And this is what this lecture is about. What is the most sophisticated thing that you could do in order to avoid those scandals and not kill your company cold? So, let's look at some privacy engineering principles, and then we will look at some tools and technologies that you can use to support those principles, right? And usually, the first thing that you should do when you're faced with an issue about collecting private data or processing it is to have a slightly clear idea of what your goal is, right? The first thing to ask yourself is my goal in itself invasive? Because you see, if you have this bright idea that you will collect data about people's race, let's say, in order to be able to provide service to people that are lighter or darker, whichever way it is, that is in itself invasive. And there is no technology that will help you solve that problem, right? I mean, if the technology you're using is, in its very core, offensive to people, you know, that's it. It's offensive to people, you shouldn't do it, end of story. But sometimes, it is not the case that the technology you want to provide in itself is invasive. It is just that the means that you may want to use in order to provide that technology might be considered offensive or may inadvertently reach some harms. So for example, again, to take the technology you mentioned earlier, what was the name of that technology?
The Amazon Echo.
The Amazon Echo wants to help you, I am sure, by providing answers to questions when you say, hey, Alexa, I believe, is that right? Good. But the means by which it does that is, of course, having a microphone that is on all the time, potentially, that could be abused to record more than when you ask a question, etc. Right? So you see that the goal is laudable. There is no problem with the goal. However, the means by which this happens in itself may create concerns that are very valid. So the way then the methodology proceeds is, after you kind of have a clear idea of the goal and a clear idea that the goal in itself is okay, then first, usually we advise to define the minimum private information that is necessary in order to achieve that goal. Okay, so the first step usually we take in creating services is what is known as data minimization. You collect only what you need to collect. Okay? And then you have, on that basis, to build a solution that kind of balances integrity of the service, because sometimes you need to collect more data in order to provide a good quality of service or a correct set of answers, etc., while at the same time you do not either collect or disclose more information to third parties as it is strictly necessary to reach your goal. Now, when I say collect information, because I work on privacy technologies, and we will see some of them in a bit, I'm quite sophisticated about what collection means and what form it has to take. So first of all, and this is what this bar represents here, the first level is that you may just have to collect some raw personal information about people, okay, and see it, and have it in your store, and process it in the clear, etc. So if I start asking you, you know, what's your favorite color, what's your health status, what's your sexual orientation, I may have to ask you that, store it, and process it in order to provide you a particular service. Okay, that's collecting in raw form information. But privacy technologies offer us also other ways of collecting information. So for example, you might want to collect information that is in an encrypted form on your servers that you cannot actually access directly, and yet by the use of modern privacy technology still be able to perform some operations in it, such as, for example, aggregating it in order to get statistics out. So for example, if I ask all of you, what is your favorite color, red and blue? One way would be for you to tell me the answer, and that's some private information that I have to hold. But another way is for you to provide me potentially something that is encrypted that represents red and blue, and me to be able to do a computation on this encrypted data to find out what is the most popular color. Okay, so that's an alternative to collecting personal information in raw, which we will see in a bit. Another alternative is for you to not collect that information on your servers and centralize it and having this big repository that represents a huge risk, but actually to provide the users with an app or with the ability to somehow input their information on a device that they own or that they trust, etc., or use a provider maybe that they trust that is not you, and perform calculations, computations, the logic of your service, either locally on the clients or on some third party that is somewhat more trusted than you are by the users, okay? And of course, some of the data is not needed and you should not collect it. You should not collect it in clear form, in encrypted form. You should not collect it on any partners or devices, etc. You should just not touch it and not seek it. Okay, so even when it comes to data you need in order to provide a service or perform some statistics or some analysis, there are gradations between just getting it all centralized, running it in massive cloud servers, versus actually decentralizing it to avoid potential harms of having very large databases that could be breached. Any questions so far? Okay. So what is this famed privacy by design that the general data protection regulation has been inspired to suggest that everyone should use? Let's look at these seven principles that predate, in fact, this directive. And again, these come from a number of references that you can follow to find out more. So they basically state some principles by which you should build your services and your software. Okay. The first one is that you should be really proactive in designing privacy into the service. You shouldn't wait for the scandal to then start giving people privacy controls and choices about their personal information. Okay? You should try to prevent the scandals and prevent potentially the harms rather than react to the harms. The second thing is that privacy really should be a default setting. It shouldn't be the case that if someone installs your app or accesses your service, by default, they would basically divulge a lot of information they did not foresee or be subject to intense scrutiny. It should be the case that they manage to, as a first experience, have an experience that is limited in terms of the potential harm and then be able to extend potentially their experience as they choose from there on by taking more or less risk according to their own preferences. The privacy should be embedded into the design. It should not be the case that somehow you have this beautiful user experience, if you want, about your product, and then a very poorly designed, unusable screen with privacy settings that no one wants to use. When users make natural actions within your system that may have repercussions on their harms that they could suffer when it comes to their privacy, the experience that allows them to understand that and allows them to effectively consent in a broader sense to that should be embedded in the design. A further principle is that you should try to provide full functionality while preserving privacy. And this is very important, you see, because if you provide a service that is super basic and not very exciting, and users that want to actually access the exciting part of the service need to give up all of their information, for example, or sacrifice their privacy or take on more potential harms, then, of course, that's a nudge towards basically going to the more privacy-sensitive or, you know, dangerous, if you want, experience, right? So your attempt should be, and this is not always possible, but at least it should be an attempt there, to provide as full functionality as possible while protecting privacy. You should think about privacy from the beginning to the end of the data lifecycle, from the collection to the storage, to the processing, but also towards the end and how you should destroy that information. And also, and this is kind of subtly a bit of a play on words, you should also think about privacy in terms of the beginning, the middle, and the end of the life of people, right? I mean, children, teenagers, young adults, students, if you want, if it is a bit earlier in life, have some privacy needs and some privacy outlooks. Professionals, people in the workforce, people who are building households have other needs and other views. People who are older also have other needs. For example, they have the needs to be assisted. And at death, people also have privacy needs. In particular, you should think about the fact that after they die, they cannot anymore remember their passwords, and their loved ones may still want to have memories and photos, etc. However, that has to happen within a controlled and legal context, right? And very often when people design services, they design them for one particular segment of one's life, making assumptions about that segment. And without really thinking about what is going to happen in 20 years' time when that has changed, or even in 5 years' time. In fact, and again, to use a concrete example, Facebook started creating its experience from the basis of U.S. university campuses, and that was geared towards having a bunch of friends going out and drinking and being in the same class, and that was awesome. Once people started transiting into professional life as well as into family life, and started having children, as well as colleagues, as well as bosses, suddenly the pictures of the beer drinking started becoming different in this new context. And suddenly, the fact that people's feeds would start filling in with the children pictures of everybody else and the cat pictures was not as interesting an experience to others as when basically they were going out drinking and having fun. So, of course, privacy controls had to become more and more sophisticated, both to prevent people from harm, but also keep it relevant for everyone. Okay, so visibility and transparency is also very important, and that is the kind of do not surprise your users principle. If you ask a user, what do you think this data will be used for? How do you think it could harm you? And they have no idea, then probably you should actually make more of an attempt as part of exposing them to your system to inform them about what is going on in the system. Anything that surprises users when it comes to their privacy is a bad thing. Okay? No one should feel betrayed Because privacy is a very emotional thing. No one should feel betrayed if they find out actually what happens with their data in their system, whether it's collected, processed, etc. And of course, it should be user-centric. Now, I say, of course, that's not a given, particularly as we will see in big data, processing is not a given. Namely, the user should be at the center of providing consent, at the center of making decisions, and at the center of defining what they find comfortable and uncomfortable. Very often, and this is an important subtlety here, I am asked, but does the average user care about X? Do most people care about Y? This is perceiving privacy in the wrong frame. I would say that 95% of the population currently in the UK would consider it entirely okay for us to go to the pub and me to post a picture of having a beer with them at the pub. I mean, the pub is the traditional socializing area, okay? However, there is a fraction of people, for example, our students who just came from Saudi Arabia, who, for whom going to the pub and having a beer and having a picture posted with them in that context could actually lead to real harm, because their family may not have been accustomed to them doing that and may have very strong feelings, for example, about this. It is not the case that because 95% of the people maybe in this country would consider that this is an entirely harmless and inconsequential activity, that somehow a system could be built that says, well, therefore we will just automatically post pictures of people in the pub, right? And I hope you remember that case study, if you want. And if anyone asks you, but do most people care about this? Oh, you know, many people will exchange their passwords or their personal information for a chocolate, etc. That is not an argument for saying, therefore, even when a minority of people minds about this, you know, they're irrelevant. And in fact, the key thing to remember is that while it may be the case that for any piece of information it is a minority that actually cares, we are all in one of those minorities. There is always something that someone will be sensitive about that the majority doesn't really care about. Okay? And, you know, if we actually go down a slippery slope of saying we will just protect the things that the majorities care about, item per item per item, we wouldn't be protecting any right of privacy at all. Okay? Good. Now, there is a seminal work by Gerses and al. In 2011 that really looks in depth about this engineering privacy by design process. And they are kind of both distilling it and they're quite critical about it at the same time. And I would like to expose you both to the distillation and some of the criticisms to avoid some of the pitfalls. So they say that the first step is to really do a functional requirements analysis on the system you're trying to build, and understand what it should be doing, and understand what is the minimum amount of information. That's the step two. Okay, once you understand what you want to do with personal information, you define what is the minimum amount of information you need. Then you kind of model potential attackers, potential threats. They follow a security engineering perspective there. That's what the threat modeling and the attacker's narrative relates to. Then they say you should follow a multilateral security requirements and analysis. Multilateral in this case means that there are many entities with needs in the system and you have to somehow balance and combine those needs so that the system still works for everyone. Okay? And finally, you have to implement that design and test it and recurse, of course, with data minimization going on from there. And one thing that they say, and I've already kind of stated that, is that the greatest pitfall is if the original functionality is poorly defined, ill-defined, or abstract, because then you cannot really effectively do data minimization. If you don't really know what your service needs or what it will need tomorrow, you have to collect everything and see what happens, right? Because you're not sure what will be needed and what will not be needed. Now, on that basis, they also expressed discomfort about the fact that even though the privacy by design principles were meant to be a technical interpretation of the otherwise data protection principles, which are mostly legal, they could still be used just as a fig leaf to build systems that the designers went through the steps of pretending they apply this checklist of privacy by design principles, but actually don't really protect privacy. And again, they basically say that you really have to embed the spirit of those in your design. Now, however, there is one type of systems, and I think this is very important for the Institute strategically, there is one type of systems that they identified as being very difficult to deal with in the context of privacy by designs, and those are what they call large-scale mandatory systems. They picked as example road tolling systems, smart energy systems, telecommunications, which are de facto mandatory, such as mobile phone networks. I like calling those kind of systems infrastructures. They're a system that usually is so embedded in what we do in our modern societies. They are so ubiquitous that you cannot really go without them, or you're forced to use them, such as, for example, systems provided by the state, like taxation, etc. Right? And these systems are very sensitive for two reasons. First of all, you cannot exercise the most basic privacy option, which is to not use it. Right? If I don't like, what was the thing that you mentioned again, the Amazon Echo, if I don't like it, I don't use it. If I see you using it in front of me, I will basically tell you to stop and go away. Fine. As long as it's not that popular and not that critical, doesn't matter. That's the most simple privacy control. However, how could you argue that this is an option when it comes to not using the road, right? Or not using even modern mobile phones? It's actually very difficult to have a normal life if you cannot use mobile phones these days, okay? So that's the first problem, that you cannot really easily opt out. And therefore, and usually when it comes to infrastructures, you may have limited choices when it comes to what you're going to use. It's not even the case that you can say, well, I'll go for the more privacy-friendly option. There is the road. That's the road. If you don't like it because it has automatic road tolling that collects data, well, you know, there is no other road. Okay, so that's the first problem, no choice. The second problem is that by their very nature, often infrastructures are there to support multiple and evolving purposes, right? If you have a thing such as a national patient record database, or a national DNA database, it is not there just to serve one purpose usually. It is there as an infrastructure that should be used in order to serve multiple purposes, and people will now assume it exists, and because they assume it exists, will use it for further purposes as well. Okay? So by the very definition of an infrastructure that everybody uses, everybody can rely on it being there, etc., this idea of the specificity of the purpose is violated, and thus it is very difficult to design specific privacy controls for the specific functionality that is needed. Okay? So a key research problem is how can we design privacy controls that are appropriate for infrastructures. Okay. That's an open research problem. I'm not going to give you any answers on that. Okay. Any questions so far? Please. Yes. Well, actually, there are works in the kind of sociology of technology literature that discuss about what is an infrastructure, how when something becomes an infrastructure. There is a very nice book called Sorting Things Out that basically mostly deals with a particular infrastructure, which is the categorization of diseases database. Okay, and it's funny, right? Because this is not records of individuals, right? And yet they describe how, for example, in defining mental illness or subdivision of mental illness or not, this has repercussions, of course, on individuals' privacy as well as how the world perceives patients, etc. And they basically argue that such databases of, for example, just categories of illnesses, etc., form an infrastructure for various reasons. And this book, Sorting Things Out, is what I would recommend you read if you're interested in what constitutes an infrastructure. And health is one particular such thing that it looks at, but it takes actually many examples. And again, it's not the case that there is an answer, that there is a definition of what is an infrastructure. It has many facets, including not having much choice about using it or assuming that it will be there as a utility, if you want, without actually having to rebuild it every time. Okay. Now, as I mentioned earlier, I spent quite a bit of my time building cryptographic solutions and as ways to facilitate the processing of personal information without exposing it to risks. And some of you may think, well, why is it the case that cryptography specifically is so intimately interlinked with building technologies that are friendly to privacy? And what kind of technologies, cryptographic technologies, are available to you if you want to build systems that help with, that are at least mindful, of privacy? So let me provide you insights about both of those things. So cryptography has been studied in the context of computer security for a very long time. Traditionally, when it comes to originally military applications, then government applications, then commercial applications, and it's used to both keep secrets, maintain the integrity of communications and stored information, etc. However, it is also used in the context of building privacy-enhanced technologies. Now, what makes privacy-enhancing technologies quite different from other security and cryptographic systems? Let's start from there in order to understand why cryptography is quite important. So, despite the fact that sometimes privacy concerns are themselves confidentiality concerns, so you may naively think, and that would be a fair thing to think a priori, that, well, you know, we have technologies to keep state secrets, right? Why don't we just use the same technologies to protect privacy, right? They're both maybe about aspects of confidentiality. We know how to build basic cryptographic tools to keep secrets or other kind of tools. Why don't we use the same kind of techniques for maintaining privacy? So the most important difference between these two different settings is what we know in security engineering as the threat model. Namely, what kind of capabilities are in the hands of an adversary that tries to violate the privacy or the confidentiality property in the context of military or government applications. And the key difference is that when you try to protect the secrets of a government or a large corporation or a large military, they basically are extremely well resourced in terms of actually physical security and protection against compulsion. They're a very powerful actor, okay? Whereas when you try to protect the privacy in terms of the secrets of individual users, they're a very weak actor. They're very exposed. If someone comes to me and says, give me your phone, otherwise I will hit you on the head, probably I will give them my phone. If you go to a military base or to a government department and say, give me your phone, unless, you know, that's not going to work out. Okay? So usually we field privacy technologies in the context where compulsion is a real risk. Okay? The potential for someone to come and compel you to do things, to give away your devices, give away your cryptographic keys, perform actions, is a very real risk, and we want to mitigate against that risk. Not only adversaries may come to compel you personally to give out something that may violate your privacy, but adversaries may go to third parties that you trust and try to compel them to collaborate with them in order to violate your privacy. And therefore, and in fact, you may be interested to hear that last week, in fact, the Investigatory Powers Bill came into effect in the UK that allows the government to go to different providers and compel them to do all sorts of different things, both provide data about individuals, as well as change the technical systems that they field in order to make it easier for the government to perform surveillance. And you know, whether this is a good or a bad thing is open for discussion, but it really illustrates that point, that compulsion is a real risk. As a result, traditionally privacy technologies have not been comfortable with assuming that there is a trusted third party that will just be entrusted with all the data in the clear, and then the whole privacy problem goes away. So traditional technologies that try to be very mindful of privacy try to not have such trusted third parties. And why not? Because, of course, you know, compulsion is a big deal, but there are many other reasons, such as the cost of running such parties, the potential carelessness of those parties to lose information, etc. So privacy-enhanced technologies usually rely more on end-user devices to locally store data and perform computations at the edges. They try to not have a single trusted third party, but multiple parties that jointly None of them knows all the secrets, but jointly manage to perform an operation, such as aggregating some data or getting some statistics. They allow users to choose who they trust instead of saying there is one party, everybody has to use that party, saying, well, maybe you can choose a provider that you trust for some reason more or less to protect you. And interestingly, as you can see, there is this tendency here, instead of actually having a single trusted party, having either multiple devices, multiple providers, multiple parties. And of course, those have to work with each other, despite potentially some of them being working with the adversary, to perform a service. And this is why cryptography is absolutely crucial there. Because both they have to communicate with each other, and that communication has to be protected, and cryptography is the only game in town to protect communications in a network. But also they may potentially have to do operations and check each other. And again, cryptography is the natural discipline that takes care of different parties working with each other, some of whom are not going to perform the operations correctly, not being able to derail the operation of the system. Okay? And that is why cryptography plays a key role, if you want, in building privacy-enhanced technologies. Not because the people who wanted to build privacy-enhanced technologies were enamored with it. It is because it is sadly necessary in order to be able to deliver quality solutions in that space. Another thing that privacy-enhanced technologies try to do is limit the window of a vulnerability of information by keeping keys ephemeral and only for a short time, as well as information that has to be in the clear, only in the clear for the shortest amount of time before it gets protected again, either by deletion or encryption or something else. Now, let me illustrate the difference between traditional security engineering and more the privacy-enhanced technologies kind of end of things by a very concrete example, which is channel security. Alice wants to talk to Bob, okay? And they want to do that over the internet or some other public wireless channel or whatever, okay? And this is the first, and they want to keep that conversation secret, okay? Now, that is the first problem that cryptography dealt with. For thousands of years. People want to communicate, they're worried that someone is in the middle, someone intercepts the courier or listens on the airwaves. How can they do this secretly? And traditional cryptography assumes that Alice and Bob will share some kind of cryptographic key, which is a short bit string that is secret and not known to anyone else. And from there, if you want, there are different known ciphers that allow you to have confidential communication on that channel. It's encrypted using the key at Alice, and then when received by Bob, it is decrypted. And traditional communication security kind of says, problem solved. Problem solved. Okay? However, privacy-enhanced technologies say, well, no, actually, the problem is not solved. Because that key is a very dangerous thing to have around. What happens if someone comes to you, or comes to Alice, since this is our context here, and says, I would like you, Alice, to give me your key, otherwise I will hit you on the head. Alice will give the key to the adversary. The adversary will be able to take basically all the material that is encrypted that they have been collecting for a while on the channel, decrypt it, and find out what she talked about with Bob. Okay? That's a problem. That's a problem. That's a very fragile system. In fact, it may expose users to more risk, physical harm, for example, than communicating in the clear. So, as a result of that, people who deal with this problem as a privacy-enhanced technologies problem invented this concept called perfect forward secrecy. And perfect forward secrecy states that after a certain amount of time, there is no amount of coercion that would allow an adversary to either go to Alice, Bob, or both in order to recover what was actually said in an encrypted conversation. And in a nutshell, the way that works is the following. Alice and Bob have a way of authenticating each other's messages, okay? Using, for example, signatures or public key cryptography or something like that. Then what they do is they perform a public key exchange that is signed or that is somehow authenticated using the long-term identifiers every time they want to chat. They use those keys that are derived from that public key exchange for the duration of the chat. And then they forget all the keying material that was specific to encrypting the data at that point. They still keep the information that allows them to authenticate each other, but nothing else. And as you can see, because the cryptographic material that is used to protect the channel for any session is fresh and forgotten immediately after the session is over, there is no amount of coercion that can be applied to Alice and Bob to then be able to recover what the conversation was about after a time. So this is just to illustrate the difference between thinking about privacy-enhanced technologies and the coercion and all that stuff versus the traditional, well, you know, you have a general versus general trying to talk to each other. They will not be coerced. That's not within the threat model. Now, if you think that this is kind of weird and maybe a little bit of a theoretical thing and, you know, how is that relevant? In fact, off-the-record messaging by Ian Goldberg and friends was proposed in 2005, 2006 that implements this for chat. This was deployed in an app called Signal that you can download for your phone. About 1 million people use that app. Great success, right? 1 million people? Would you be happy if 1 million people use your app? No. Are you ready? WhatsApp implemented it. 1 billion people now on WhatsApp are basically using perfect forward secrecy. So it is the de facto gold standard now. If you want to build chat and you don't provide perfect forward secrecy, you know, you're not in the game. Okay? So this is the kind of time frame that it took for the deployment of that technology. Now, one thing that privacy technologies are concerned about is protecting metadata. For protecting the actual data in transit or in storage, encryption usually does a good job, and you should use it when you want to protect data either in transit or in storage. If you don't use it, it's your bad. However, the problem is that sometimes what is really sensitive is not what is said, but who talks to whom, for how long, how often. Classic example is Alice talks to Bob. Bob is a cancer doctor, right, an oncologist. You know, it already kind of gives you a bit of a feel for maybe what they would be talking about. What if they start talking really often? You know, it gives you an even more of a feel about maybe what's going on with Alice, right? Alice browses the NHS website, and she's actually looking at pages on sexually transmitted diseases. Now, the content is public of these pages, right? It's not like there are secrets on the NHS website, right? But the mere fact that Alice is actually performing an action, downloading a particular resource, already kind of gives you potentially more information than is necessary. So there is extensive research that shows how much can be inferred by metadata. There were studies, for example, that show that if people know your friends on Facebook and they know their sexual orientation, they have a much better than random guess about what your sexual orientation is. And this is just, again, connections, homophily effectively playing a role there by saying that, you know, if you're more friends with people who are like this or like that, you're also more likely to be like this and like that. The same was true about political opinions. The same was true about a number of other things. I do refer you to the studies. They're very interesting. So one aim of privacy technologies has been to try to hide who is talking to whom and other metadata. And this is what the Onion Router and other anonymous communication technologies try to do. Okay? They try to strengthen the concept of channel security, to not just hide content, but also metadata of communications. And the way they usually do that is by having a number of relays between Alice and, let's say, some website she wants to access, and those relays relaying all the communication in such a way that anyone that observes either a subset of relays or just the network cannot very easily tell which way the communications are going because many people are using those relays at the same time. Okay? Now, again, this really illustrates this argument that I made that privacy technologies are best deployed in the context where there is no single trusted third party that takes care of all the property. So you could imagine of an anonymity system that hides who's talking to whom as a single relay. Alice and others are sending some messages to the relay. They should be encrypted so that they look different. They get decrypted. They send to Bob from Alice and other people as well. That would provide perfect anonymity in some ways, between those three messages coming in and out. Alice is actually talking to Bob, but no one knows. However, there is a single proxy, an adversary that has compulsion powers, would go to them and say, ooh, I would like you to tell me who's talking to whom. And in fact, this happened in the mid of 1990s. There was a relay like that called pnet.fi. And the Church of Scientology saw some of its documents leaked through that relay and went to the operator through the courts and requested basically the information about who sent a particular message. So modern privacy technologies try to avoid having such single points of failure, as you should in good security engineering. And in fact, the system that I presented to you before would be implemented using multiple mixes, some of whom may be corrupt, some of them would not be corrupt. And of course, in the case of low latency, these will just relay streams of data instead of single messages to achieve onion routing. OK, so this is how we get metadata secrecy, if you want, in the context of communications. Now, another thing that you might want to allow is people to look up information privately. And in fact, this is the setting where Alice is looking up the NHS database for a particular disease, etc. And of course, one way of achieving that is anonymizing the traffic and providing channel encryption. That's one way of achieving it. But sometimes this is impractical. And there is a whole subfield of applied cryptography called private information retrieval that deals exactly with this. Alice wants to look up a record into a database. The database is public. That's not what the problem is here. But she wants to make sure that which record is being accessed is kept secret from the database and the rest of the world as well. Okay? And there are a couple of solutions for doing this. It may seem impossible to you, but it's not impossible, because of course there is a trivial solution. She downloads the whole database and then looks locally at the record, right? I mean, that's a trivial solution, so it can happen. The question is, can we do it more efficiently than just by downloading the whole database locally? And it turns out we can. I don't have time to go into it right now, but if you want more information about this, let me know. So that's private information retrieval. It is even simpler, and this is quite cute, if, in fact, the database is some private information that Alice has put up in a cloud that now she's using in order to look up records from. So if you have your own data, you encrypt your own data, you permute your own data, and you put it up in the cloud, then looking up particular records without telling anyone which particular records you're looking in on a particular day is actually quite cheap and quite simple to achieve. And that's exactly the setting you want for cloud storage. Right? I mean, if you use the cloud for storage, you want both the content of the data to be hidden, but also the metadata about which record you're looking at tomorrow. Good. Now, what I have covered so far is the kind of easy end of things, because it's really about protecting communications, both content and metadata, and it is about protecting storage, either because you encrypt it or you want to make lookups or seek particular blocks from a disk without revealing which ones you're accessing. Okay. The difficulties about protecting privacy come when you start to try to process personal information. Okay, because how could you possibly process personal information without seeing it, without having it on your processor, right? It's kind of difficult to fathom how you would do that. So there are some both extremely inspirational and powerful scientific results, as well as some very depressing facts. So I'll start with the happy news. The happy news is that very early on, from the 80s onwards, we know that if you have a number of parties that each have a private input, and they would like to perform a joint computation on that input without revealing anything about the input except for whatever is revealed by the result of the computation, they can do that. This is called secure multi-party computation. So if we all basically had some input and we would like to apply a function to our joint inputs and reveal the result, we could do that without revealing anything about our initial results, except, of course, what is revealed at the very end from the final result. That's pretty cool. And you can basically do pretty much any function, okay? As long as it terminates. Basically, you can do it, okay? That's cool. So in theory, the problem should be solved. And in fact, not only you can do it in one way, you can do it in two ways. There are two broad families of techniques. One family of techniques would have us share our secrets with each other, but in shares, in such a way that no single individual has anyone else's secret. Okay? And then we do joint computations by communicating with each other that will end up with a secret at the end. So that's a kind of interactive set of protocols. And they work quite fast, but they need communications between the different parties. A second technique was enabled maybe 5-7 years ago by the invention of fully homomorphic encryption. That is encryption that allows you to encrypt some information and still do additions and multiplications of the plain text through the encryption, which is pretty cool. That's quite magical. Now, that in that setting, what we can do is we can encrypt our personal data. We can provide them to a third party. That third party can manipulate this encrypted information to finally have the encryption of the result and then provide it to someone that will decrypt it and give the result out. Okay, so that's a non-interactive setting. However, despite all of this happy news here, that in theory you can actually do any function jointly and without revealing the secrets, there are also some bad news. A normal computer will do over 1 billion operations a second. Okay? That's cool, we have come to expect that. When you use these techniques for actually doing computations, you end up being able to do 1, 10, 100, depending on the shape of your computation, a second. Okay? So in effect, you are forced to use a computer from the 1940s to the 1950s, which is not that cool, right? Because when we say we want to process information, personal information or other, we want to process it at the speeds that we expect computers to process today. We want to do big data analytics. It's not going to work if we are basically reduced to using a computer from the 1940s. Okay? In the 1940s, there was no big data. All right. So that's the bad news here. In theory, it's possible. In practice, it's very slow and very painful. However, all of this depends on the shape of the computation. There are some computations for which it is actually very fast to do private computations. For example, if the only thing we need to do is extract some sums of our secrets, and that's quite useful, right? For example, to running a poll within a population, to get variances, to get summary statistics, sums are exactly what you want, okay? Then it can be done extremely fast. And that can be used in order to implement systems such as private road tolling, authentication, authorization systems. It can be used to do private statistics. Detecting common elements in the set in two private sets turns out to be extremely fast. There are specific computations that we know shorthands that allow us to actually do them fast. And in fact, this is why there is a whole field of privacy-enhanced technologies, because every time one of the data users comes to us and say, well, I would like to do this thing, we tell them, well, in theory it is possible it would be slow, but let me think of maybe a more specific technique that would allow us to do the computation you want without actually leaking any information. So please, this is just an advertising talk. If you have any problem and you're worried that your users won't give you the data and yet you need to compute, come to me and my colleagues, because we are delighted to actually building systems that are used in real life. Okay, good. And in fact, one of the example deployments that I was involved in is a testbed for privacy-friendly aggregation for smart metering. You have lots of meters in people's homes. You want to find out how much in this region is consumed at that time of the day on a Friday. Boom, we can tell you that without anyone having access to the raw meter records. Same for billing. Let's say the unit of electricity changes over the day. Your smart meter gives me encrypted meter readings. I can actually do a weighted sum privately without revealing what the meter readings were. Okay, so some private computations are faster than others. Don't give up because in general they're slow. Come and talk to us. We might actually be able to help. Finally, there are things that are known as zero-knowledge proofs. Okay, and this is quite weird very often because they're kind of mysterious things. So let me give you a bit of a motivating example of where these technologies are used. As I said earlier, one of the tricks we use when we build privacy technologies is instead of taking data in our centralized data centers, doing the processing there, giving back results, we heavily rely on user devices to actually perform computations. But of course, there are dangers in relying on user devices. Let's take the example of billing. Okay? Imagine instead of collecting a lot of data about people's energy usage at home to bill them for what energy they consumed on our data centers, imagine we actually give them that data on their mobile phone and they have to compute the final bill and tell the utility provider how much they should be paying for electricity. Now that would be privacy friendly in that no one learns the energy consumption in the household, but of course, There is a problem with that. Who knows what the problem is? Is it just compromised? There is actually an even more incentives compatible problem. The user whose phone it is has incentives for the phone not to work correctly and say, I did not consume any electricity. Therefore, when we basically, as a privacy technique, rely on user devices for those devices to do computations on which we will rely, such as billing, or such as profiling, or such as targeting ads, and then billing our partners for them, how do you know that these user devices did the right thing if you didn't see the original data and you don't trust basically the device code that is running because the user will actually change it? Wouldn't it be nice if we had a way to run the computations on private data on user devices, get the results, and be sure that those results are correct, namely they're the right computation on the right encrypted or otherwise hidden data that we haven't seen? Wouldn't it be nice? And in fact, this is exactly what these zero-knowledge proofs do. They allow us to perform computations on secrets and associate with the result of those computations a proof that the computations were done correct without revealing those secrets. Okay? And in fact, again, for any computation, we can produce a rather short proof that the result of the computation was correct, that does not reveal anything about its inputs, but yet tells us that the computation was done correctly. And this is why this is a key ingredient in the panoply of privacy-enhanced technologies. Okay. Now, not all privacy-enhanced technologies are equally mature. I think that I've already given you a hint about that. Perfect forward secrecy as a technology, for example, is fielded in 1 billion devices through WhatsApp. Anonymity systems like Tor are used by millions of people. Zero-knowledge proofs, there are pilots, they are also used by hundreds of thousands of people. Specific private computations, for example, for billing in the context of the smart grid, such as things that I have worked in, are used by thousands of people in pilots. PIR or RAM and generic computations are used by tens, hundreds of researchers in the lab. Okay, and there is a reason for that, because in that order they become less and less efficient, and as a result we're still working actively in trying to make them faster so that we can scale up their adoption and take out limitations. Okay. Now, however, I do not want you to step out of this talk and assume that the only concern and the only type of technologies that there exist to protect privacy are related with cryptography. There are also other things that you might want to use or consider using in the panoply of technologies that will help you protect privacy. In particular, things around anonymization, controls of usage, logging, etc. So what are these non-cryptographic techniques? And there I'm going to give a slightly more nuanced view of what is possible and what is not possible. So the first technology that, particularly data scientists, statisticians, people who handle data, have as their go-to when it comes to protecting privacy is anonymization. What is anonymization? Anonymization techniques take a data set that is usually linkable with two particular individuals through the records or whatever, and then put it through the anonymization system, and they hope that they will get a data set that has all of the same value to the analyst, all of the same utility, as we usually call it, and yet is no more linkable to particular individuals, and therefore represents a lesser harm, and in fact it is excluded from data protection regulations, as it turns out, because lawyers were convinced that it's not risky anymore, right? No data can be linked back to individuals. Now, the problem with this technique is the risks inherent in what is known as de-anonymization. Namely, de-anonymization is effectively trying to do the opposite, taking an anonymized website that has records that do not have obvious identifiers associated with them, and from that data set, trying to link records either to living individuals or try to learn something about a particular linked, particular individual that was in the original data set. Okay? And the problem with anonymization is that the more complex, the more rich, the more interconnected your original and your anonymized data set, the harder it is to prevent re-identification or de-anonymization attacks. Let me just give you a bit of an insight about why. The reason for that is that everything within the anonymized data set can be used in order to link to a real individual if you have even a little bit of side information. So let's take the example of a database of patient records at the NHS that contains, for example, the dates and the times of visits to the doctor. Now, the date and time of a visit to the doctor is not in itself an identifier for you, right? It's just a date and a time. It's not your face, it's not your name, it's not your address. However, your employer, from whom you potentially took holidays, your spouse, your mobile phone provider that knows which masts your phone was connected to, has in fact sufficient information to link you to that record, right? So there are a lot of sources of side information that can be linked to this pretty much unique pattern of the dates and the times you went to the doctor that would allow them to link you as an individual to that record. And if that record was to become known to them or public, because it's not sensitive, it's not full of private information, therefore why not make it public, then they would be able to know that you, the customer of the mobile phone provider, or your spouse would find out about you, what you visited the doctor about, potentially what diseases you discussed and whatnot. Okay? And this is the difficulty there in actually trying to build robust anonymization procedures. It is the fact that it is not just the sensitive information that is it's not just the identifiable information that should be purged, namely your name, your address, or other identifiers. Anything else in some context can also act as an identifier that links a record to an individual and then gives whoever links it more information about that individual. So the current thinking is, and please read this reference, Myths and Fallacies of Personally Identifiable Information, the current thinking is that anonymization can reduce potentially the harm a little bit, but by no means should be used as the only protection around data sets, particularly data sets that would cause significant harm if some individuals were to be re-identified. Okay? So it's a layer of defense, but it cannot be used as the defense. Okay? Great. Now, not everyone is convinced about that, and there are lots of people who still rely on anonymization for providing their privacy needs. This is not a risk to us, it's an opportunity, because there is this field of research that basically tries to find de-anonymization attacks, and I invite you, when you see that, to bring it to my attention, because it's a hobby of mine to actually break anonymization scheme by showing that it is actually quite easy to de-anonymize them as a public service to illustrate that point. So that sounds a bit depressing, right? That sounds a bit depressing. You're like, well, if I cannot have access to my anonymized data, how am I going to do research? I'm a data scientist. I need data. And, you know, if it is not anonymized, well, you know, what do I do? So there is some good news here. The good news is that it is not known to us how you can take a data set and make a data set that is not sensitive, that is not linkable back to individuals. However, what we know how to do is to have a data set and make queries into that data set that provide answers, usually summary answers, and then add a little bit of noise to that result in order to make sure that it is not overly sensitive to any particular individual and therefore doesn't leak too much information about any particular individual. Okay? These notions are known as differential privacy. The inventor of differential privacy, Cynthia Dwork, is giving a talk on December 5th here. So this is why I could give a whole lecture on that, because there are actually extremely credible techniques from doing data analysis, because you can define your data analysis algorithm as the query, send it to the data, get back the results, add a little bit of noise, rely on those results because you know how to actually do sensitivity analysis given the noise and work out if it is a reliable result, and then still make sure that not too much information leaks from that database. Now, there are ideas, so please go to the December 5th talk. I will actually be here and I will invite also all my students, because it's a fantastic opportunity from the creator of those kind of techniques to find out how they work. Now, there are also some ideas that are broadly bad ideas. One bad idea is to say that because these days we live in a world of big data, it is very difficult to seek consent from users or to inform users, to have a user-centric approach to privacy, And therefore, what we should do instead is collect a lot of data without particularly bothering about people giving consent or being okay with it or whatever, and then impose controls on usage. Okay? So have some kind of committee of elders decide, is the usage of this data in a particular context okay or not? So not really having a user-centered approach. So a concrete example would be to say, well, we collect all of the data from the NHS, and then we have a committee of ethicists and other experts in what is good and what is bad. Ethicists, by the way, are not experts in what is good and what is bad, but anyway, decide, well, would it be okay to use it for this particular type of experiment or not? Okay? Now, this is fraught with problems. Okay, this is fraught with problems. The first problem is, of course, that you know, it is kind of impossible to second guess what people are sensitive about and what they're not. It is also very difficult to actually impose the discipline after you have collected data on further usage controls in a way that is simpler than actually having controls when you collect the data. Okay, so this is an ongoing conversation, and it's a conversation in the context of cloud services and big data that I would love to have and develop with you as part of the Alan Turing Institute. Okay, but basically, never use that argument as a substitute for, well, let's collect all the data and people will just have to trust that we do the right thing because we have some kind of high-level governance thing. Okay, always try to have the user at the center of you know, their preferences about privacy. You're not an expert on people's preferences. They are the expert on their preferences. Sadly, Craig Mundy from Microsoft, advising President Obama, was more of that opinion. Okay. Finally, one mechanism that people sometimes have in mind when it comes to protecting privacy, and this is quite perverse in some ways, to keep more logs. What I mean by that is to say, well, we will have a big database of a lot of data, and then we will just log all the accesses to that data and log all the views and log all the uses and all that stuff. And if someone does something wrong, we will find them, right? And we will go back to the logs and, you know, punish them. Now, this in theory is a fine strategy. And if you have no other option, maybe that is a good option. However, don't forget that when you actually have a database of personal information that is operational in many ways, and then you keep logs, the logs themselves may actually be sensitive. Okay? So for example, if I have a database of people with different illnesses, and some of them have cancer, and some of them just have an itchy foot, and now I run a script that basically does analysis about some cancer, you know, which particular records it has touched, what script touched which records, when, who initiated it, and all that stuff, in itself may divulge the private information in the database. Okay? So keeping logs may actually increase perversely your attack surface when it comes to privacy than having more appropriate mechanisms, and therefore is not just a kind of free pass to solving the problem, and it is very much not preventative of problems. It is really about if a problem occurs, if a scandal occurs, finding out who to punish, which should not really be the way we think. As a final note, one thing that actually privacy technologies rely on, which again is not cryptographic in nature, is transparency. Transparency of the logic. And I think, again, this is a strategic opportunity for the Alan Turing Institute. One reason why people trust Signal, people trust Tor, and other systems that I have presented to you so far, is because what they do is they very transparently create software that others run in order to protect privacy. And in fact, transparency is in itself a very interesting mechanism to build confidence, user confidence, about what our systems are doing. If you manage to build software that users can see, or the people who they trust can see what it does, and they run it on their own devices or devices of providers that they trust, even if it manages and accesses their personal information, that provides a higher level of assurance than if you have a bunch of code and a bunch of script that no one can see, no one understands, in a private data center looking at all the scripts, and you don't even tell people that those scripts are running on their data. Okay? I'm presenting here the two extremes, if you want, of on one side, total transparency of the code running on third-party providers that guarantee that only that will happen, or even user devices, versus total closeness, no ability to actually audit, view, understand what is going on. Okay? So always try to veer more on the side of transparency than the other one, because that's what creates assurance and that's what keeps us honest. Okay, so In conclusion, I think I have motivated enough the approach we have to privacy engineering and also gave you a bit of a feel for what it takes, at least as much of a feel as I can in an hour and a half. As I mentioned, cryptography usually is a necessary gateway if you're going to build an operational system that has strong privacy protections. However, other things such as query privacy may also do the job if you just want to do some private data analysis, etc. Now, for more of that, please talk to myself as well as other people working in security engineering here, including actually some of our UCL students who specialize in these technologies who are currently based here. I'd be happy to answer any questions, either here or later.
In real world, how do you test accuracy of your aggregated statistics? Because you don't have access to original data.
So it depends on what you do. So some of the aggregation techniques don't introduce any noise. So there are two objectives to private aggregation. And depending what objective you have, you may or may not have noise. One objective may be that you want to aggregate some private inputs without having access to the original inputs, okay, in a distributed manner. But you're not overly sensitive about whatever can be learned from the final aggregate, the sum. And then you provide an exact aggregate. So the actual result you get out is the exact sum, or the exact variance, or whatever. Now, of course, the second concern may then kick in, namely, what if I am sensitive about what inferences I could draw about individual inputs from the final output? And then you need to introduce some noise. And then you have to apply this idea from differential privacy. And then you have to basically calculate what is known in those contexts as the sensitivity of the function. And then you have a known noise distribution that is added to that data. And therefore, you can actually calculate what your error bounds are. And if the error bounds are within the acceptable error bounds, then you accept it. Otherwise, you don't accept it in exactly the same way as when you deal with noisy data.
Okay? I was thinking about if any zero knowledge proof technique can be used.
To work out what? But you don't have to. That's the nice thing. Because you know what your error bounds are. So you cannot do any better than that because that would divulge information, sadly. If you knew any more, you know, that, well, my error bars are like this, but actually my error is like that, then, you know, you haven't basically done the proper query anonymization job. Yeah. Please.
Hi, thanks for your very informative talk. I was wondering to what extent your work actually focuses, in addition to a more application layer, which is signal and whatnot, to looking at the logical layer, so looking at DNS over TLS, HTTPS, so these things that are more aimed at, I don't want to say taking the end user out of the picture, but making sure that you have certain forms of privacy protections that don't necessarily require the end user understanding or downloading or working with it or et cetera.
Yeah, so in fact, I feel a bit like a fraud giving the talk here, if you want, because all of my work has to do with things that the users will never see. Okay, 100%. The reason for that is because at UCL, we actually have experts that work on usable security, and they have convinced the rest of us that unless we're very serious about doing that, namely doing user studies and all that stuff, we should never really expose anything to the user. So methodologically, if you want, and this is just my preference, I mean, it's not that the other work is actually more important to some extent, but myself methodologically being a computer scientist by training, I choose to basically take systems that exist, if you want, without strong privacy protections, and conceptualize how could we implement exactly the same user experience but with strong privacy protections underneath, in such a way that the user never even realizes that something different is happening. Okay, and my methodological starting point is that my user experience vis-a-vis the technology is going to be exactly the same as the user experience they have now. If it is good, it's good. If it's no good, it's no good, but it's not my fault. Okay, so in particular, we're working on these private aggregation techniques where, you know, as far as users are concerned, they have a smart meter, but instead of giving readings in the clear, they give encrypted readings, and the whole thing works. I work on key management techniques where people just add friends on Facebook or whatever social network, and then their communications are encrypted, and they don't particularly have a sense about why or how or, you know, anything different happening. We work on anonymous communication channels where, again, you think that you're just talking, Alice is talking to Bob, however, their metadata are not exposed. And we try to, at least besides, you know, maybe some delay or some, you know, very low-level qualitative metrics, the user shouldn't really be aware of what is going on. Yeah. User experience in relation to privacy is also a huge topic. And if you're interested in that, I would invite you to see Professor Angela Sasse's keynote at the Privacy Enhanced Technology Symposium this year in 2016. She gave an hour lecture on exactly the topic of more user-facing technologies and also the methodologies that you need to use in order to really make sure that users will understand what's going on, configure it right, not be fooled to turn it off, etc. Thank you.